Name Bruce, rest of my daisy. And today we've got in video, and I must admit, I really don't know what I'm going to tell you about these things aside from trying to share with you the experiments I've been running for the last couple of days. The topic du jour is air tubes. What's an air tube? It's a critical part of the daisy. Air tubes are what actually gather the air from the compression chamber, guide it through this tiny little hole here, and then up the spout. And when this makes contact with the BB, knocks the BB out of the way, and then lets all that pressurized air flow into the shot tube, power the BB, and off the target it goes. So it's a critical component. And to understand air tubes and what I'm going to be talking about today, we got to go back and look at air tubes of yore, the air tubes of yesteryear, because today's topic is basically, if you'll notice on these two air tubes, this is a factory standard daisy air tube. This is a factory standard daisy air tube that's been overbored. It's a 764 diameter for better airflow. And you'll notice that they're both similar in one aspect, is and that aspect is that they have an air inlet notch on one side of the tube, but they have nothing on the other side of the tube. They are both the same that way. So it's a single notch system that Daisy is defaulted to as a standard production technique. No dual ports. Now what makes this air tube a little different is this air tube is not a Daisy product. It is a thin wall stainless tube, and you'll see that that interior diameter is much larger than the other ones. And the other change that this one's got on it that the other two don't have is that it has two holes, so it's a dual port air tube. Now this has surfaced in the modding community in the last week or so as a result of the activities of Jonathan Bates over at Black Barrel Customs. He builds air tubes out of brass, and they are dual port air tubes, and he puts them in guns that he builds that are very unique. I'll put a link to his YouTube channel in the description below. You need to take a trot over there and take a look at some of his work. He builds a Kentucky long rifle replica based on a 105B buck that I'm just enchanted by. It looks good, it shoots good, and with this air tube and a super long barrel, he's getting really impressive velocities out of guns with standard spring packages in them. Basically, the mainspring, the 105 buck, is the same as the Red Ryder mainspring, but he's seeing numbers that normally I have to do three mods to get to. So it's intrigued me. And that has led to today's video about dual port air tubes. But before we talk about the results I got with this one I fabricated, let's go back and do a little history. All right, back in the day, way back in the day, 1910, 1920, when Daisy first started building air guns, they had an air tube that looked like this. This is called a top hat shot tube, or top hat style shot tube, or air tube, pardon me. It is a solid steel plug at the base of the air tube. It has a pin to attach it to the end of the plunger assembly. And then that's followed up by a steel washer. I know it's hard to see on this, but that is actually a steel washer under there that has a leather seal and then a top hat assembly at the top. Now what you'll notice about the top hat is it's got two holes. So this was a dual port or dual inlet air tube, but it's configured much different than the current product. It has a little metal cap that it sits on. It's got two spots for air to get into the air tube and then transition up through the air tube into the BB. Now, this one is one that's had its leather seal removed to give you a better idea of how the construction is. The plug is not straight, it's tapered. And it's tapered, oh, look at that, everything's falling apart. It's tapered so that the washer only goes up X amount of distance. And the reason that is that way is that the mainspring binds directly on the washer, not on the cross pin like the modern gun. And this is what the washer looks like. You'll see that it's leather, so it actually forms to the top hat. So when it's installed, this is what it looks like. And the mainspring pushes on the back of the washer, not on the cross pin, like the modern guns do. And that forms a really good seal. But we're going to take that off now because we want to take a look at how the top hat is constructed. Now you'll notice that that's actually kind of crimped on the lip of the base of the air tube assembly, and it has two inlet holes. So back in the day, back in the 10s and 20s and 30s, Daisy was running air tubes that had dual ports. All right, so it's not exactly brand new, never done, never been thought of before, but it's not a current technology, one that's currently in production. But dual portage did exist in days gone by. All right, so we got that covered. The next thing, that's old air tubes that work with bottle cap style air guns, like so. Oh, and here's the other thing I wanted to show you. This is actually an abutment washer. Often you'll hear me refer to the abutment washer. You'll see that written in the literature. This is a metal piece that fits down inside the barrel shroud, and it's mounted like so in the gun. This would be toward the muzzle. And a bottle cap essentially just threads into it, like this. Well, a little easier than that. Usually, this is probably a gummed up, beat up. It's not in a gun for a reason, but they thread in like so. But you'll get to a point with them where they free spool, and this one has some schmutz in it, so it's not gonna allow me to demonstrate that to you. But it should be a get in there and just free spool. And the reason it has to free spool is so that the BB trap that's normally on an air tube will keep BBs from falling out of the hole when you're levering the gun. All right, so that's why it allows it to free spin. But then when you back it out, it comes out, it goes in, it comes in, it goes in. And it is the abutment washer. That's what this is called. It's a metal piece. It stays in the gun. And this is the abutment seal that will sit against the washer in an older leather seal bottle cap gun. And you can see here on the front where the impression of the top hat has been made. And that's what seals the gun up so that the air charge can be compressed. That's bottle cap technology, all right? Modern technology, we have the combined fixed abutment. It's a combination piece of aluminum and plastic. It has a fixed abutment seal. And you'll note that that seal does have two characteristics that you do not see on the earlier stuff, all right? It's got these two ridges. And the modern compression cup has got two slots cut into it to accommodate those ridges so that when this goes in the gun and the trigger gets pulled, the seals, the slots, have to line up with the relief ports. Otherwise, it won't go poof, poof, poof. See, they have to line up, they have to be together. Which explains why the relief cut on the modern gun is on set up so that it's in the channel, so that the last thing that the relief port sees before the compression cup has done its job and sealed it is the interface of that cutout. All right, so that's a single input port, single panel, doesn't have a dual port on it. All right, and that's the difference between the old style system and the new style system. Well, Jonathan works in new style guns. He works primarily in 105 bucks. And they have this style of abutment. And he did an interesting video on a gun he's calling Bleeding Blue, which is a replica long rifle. And it's got pretty incredible velocity. And after watching the video, I became enchanted with the idea that maybe it's because it's using a dual port air tube. I don't know. So I decided I would build one and find out, which led to this development. This is a piece of thin wall stainless. So we crimped it, we drilled it, and we cross-drilled it. Now, when I cross-drilled it, I made a faux pas. I didn't do it quite right. I managed to get my ports set up so that they would be completely blocked by the sidewalls. Ran some tests. It wasn't running as fast as it had run with just a standard 764 overbore air tube. Lost about 20 feet a second. I couldn't figure out why. So I ran the gun for 450 rounds. Just to make sure that I wasn't going to run into other issues, like, oh, I don't know, it breaking off because it had been drilled twice, not once, or if the tip of the air tube started to deform and peen over excessively. Those would be indicators that maybe the material isn't quite thick enough for the application we're trying to do. But it ran 450 rounds through the gun, which was a super thumper, and didn't have any issues. Pulled it apart, took a look at it, and realized my mistake, that when I had fabricated it, instead of having it situated like so, it in fact was sitting like that. So I refabricated it, repositioned it correctly, put it back in the gun, and ran some more chrono tests on it so that it actually could had a port open to where air could get to it. And lo and behold, it was 20 feet a second slower than it was when it was this way. So now I'm befuddled. I can't call the experiment success, except for the fact that the tube itself is wearing in pretty well for the amount of rounds it has had put through it. But it's not giving me more pressure, more airflow, higher velocities on the BBs. I'm not quite sure why. So I know that Daisy used dual port in the past successfully. I know that Jonathan's tests in brass tubes with dual port design have been successful, but he is using a lot longer shot tube. It's all part of the mystery at the moment. But I can tell you for a fact that a standard barrel Red Ryder with this tube with two ports is not going to run as fast as a standard barrel Red Ryder with an overbore air tube with just one hole. Don't quite know why yet, but that's the reality. Now, a lot of folks get concerned or get confused about just how much room is there in a Daisy for the compression chamber. So we're going to go to the cutaway and see if we can illustrate this. Now, this is a 105 buck cutaway. So right up here in this part is where this sits. And it's got the funky brand new one piece, one size fits all abutment system. It's parked right there. And when we cycle the gun, we notice that when we're at battery, which is ready to fire, that our air tube is right there. So if our abutment system is right here, when the gun's cocked, what should be happening is when I move it forward, you'll see that the shiny part shows up in that little hole right there. Okay, that's fired, this is cocked. It's just slightly behind there, so a BB has room to get down in there, get in front of the air tube, and when you pull the trigger, the whole thing goes forward. So that's the distance we're talking about in terms of what gets compressed and how big the cylinder is. Not very damn large. What, 2 1/4 inches perhaps. I'll get a tape on that later and get a hard number for you. But that's how the firing cycle goes. The BB gets magnetically sucked into the chamber. The tip of the air tube strikes the BB, compresses the air charge. That air is funneled up through the tube, into the shot tube, and out the barrel. And that's how she works. And this is, let's watch this. It's not slow-mo, but it's real time. So that's where we're at today. We have fabricated a thin wall stainless tube with an incredibly fat bore, and it does not give us more air. But I think the mistake I made was drilling a dual port. I should have made this a single port design to start with, tested it, got numbers off of it, and then went to dual port to see if there was a change. The end result's going to be that I'm going to fabricate another one of these and just stop at the first hole and see what the numbers are. But right now, don't see an improvement on the dual port design for my applications, although Jonathan is seeing quite a bit. I'd advise you all to go and take a look at the video because it's a neat video. It's got some impressive numbers. Well, hopefully you're thoroughly confused now, but that's all the time we've got for this today, kids. This is Shane Bruce with Resto My Daisy, signing off.